Hi, Mr. Farmer. We are here to present our Introduction to Land Economics group assignment to you. So our group members are Thi Pui Pui, Thi Vi Ya, and me, Fong Wing Kee.
Good morning, Mr. Fawaz, and to everyone. I'm Thivya Karnan, and today I'll be presenting on the factors causing the house price to increase beyond the affordability. Now, one of the reasons that causes the house price to increase is due to the population. So when the population grows, the housing demand and supply increases, which causes the house price to increase. All right. According to the Department of Statistics Malaysia, the urban population shows an upward trend in which it has amplified from 62% to 71% from year 2000 to 2010, as shown in the graph below. Based on Bank Negara Malaysia, the quantity of households have amplified from 5.7 million in year 2005 to 7.4 million within 10 years. However, the total number of houses supplied in our country has only increased from 3.7 million into 4.9 million throughout the 10 years. Hence, you can actually see a mismatch between the housing supply and also the number of households. Therefore, as a result of growing population, the housing demand and supply has increased, which indirectly causes the housing prices in the suburban areas to increase. All right, the graph here basically shows that the nearer the location of the places to the central business district, which is the Kuala Lumpur, the greater the population density, resulting into a higher housing price that is caused by a high demand. As you can see, the graph basically illustrates on the undersupply of new residential property. It's an example of case study in which from year 2011 to 2014, there was a shortage in the supply of new houses, which has elevated the demand among the households. The number of new households within year 2011 to 2014 is about 118,000, which is greater than the average supply of houses, which are 85,000. So as a result of high demand, the house prices have increased beyond the affordability. Another reason that causes the house price to increase beyond the affordability of the population is due to the poor growth of income. So there are two methods in using that are being used in estimating the highest affordable prices, which is via the approach of housing cost burden and also the median multiple approach. In housing cost burden, it mentions that a residential property is assumed affordable if the housing cost does not increase 30% of the net income per month. While in median multiple approach, it mentions that a residential property is measured affordable when the median house price is less than 3 times of the median annual household income. All right, the graph here basically illustrates on the undersupply of affordable houses and the oversupply of unaffordable houses. As you can see, the supply of affordable houses that is below 250,000 is low. However, the availability of high-cost houses that's worth 500,000 and above is greater. The undersupply of affordable houses has made it difficult for home buyers to purchase the residential property. This is because the household income does not match the housing price. All right, here's just an example of case study in which in year 2014, for citizens earning a monthly household income of 4,585 will have an annual income of 55,020 ringgit. So by using the 3 times median multiple approach, the affordable cost for this particular citizen would be 165,060 ringgit. However, the median house price is about 242,000 ringgit, which is very expensive and makes the house extremely unaffordable. All right, another reason that causes the housing price to increase beyond the affordability is due to the foreign direct investment. The government policy for foreigners enables foreigners to buy houses worth greater than a million, which has prompted the property developers to build and participate in high-end residential properties as they have foreign purchasers who are willing to invest in our country. So first, it's important to understand the consequences of foreign real estate investment on the prices of residential property in Malaysia. When more foreigners are investing, the demand of the residential property in Malaysia increases. This causes the level of foreign capital to increase into the house market of our country, which indirectly inflates the housing price. Now, despite the benefits in strengthening the economy, it has also resulted in an increase in the house price, which makes it difficult for many citizens to purchase a house as they are not affordable due to their low household income. Another reason that causes the housing price to increase beyond the affordability is due to the easy access to financing. Majority of the banks offer financing up to 90% of the house price for the first 2 houses that you will be owning. Due to the high lendings for home mortgages, it has resulted into a strong demand and supply by the developers, which has led to an increase in the house price. So house prices increases because buyers not only purchase the house for shelter purposes, but they buy houses for investment purposes, discounts, and they also buy houses if there's any discount obtained from the developer project, and also for custom-built houses. Therefore, since the mortgage repayment is lower and the home loan tenor is much more longer, this has enabled people to buy houses priced beyond what they could afford, which prompted the developers to build more houses at an elevated price. Therefore, a rapid escalation of housing prices due to the effective housing demand, which was backed by easy access to financing. All right, the next factor that causes the housing price to increase beyond the affordability would be the land cost and cost of construction. So an example of case study that occurred in year 2016 would be the cost of steel bar has increased from 1,500 to 2,450 per ton from January to April 2016 within the same year. This has affected the contractors who had secured construction contract with the government or the private sectors, as they have to follow the price negotiated. Therefore, in order to overcome the losses, the developers increases 5%, which causes the houses that are being built to increase in price. Another reason that causes the housing price to increase is due to the cost of land. So as you can see in the graph, the land price has increased with a compound yearly growth rate of 7.8%. And it is notable that the price of the land and the price of the house moved at the same pace, which explains that land cost plays an important role in the price of the residential property. So the reason why land cost increases are basically due to the use of land, local planning guidelines, whether the land consists of fundamental infrastructure, and also the proximity to main city center. So the land cost is higher in a denser population due to the high demand, and the land cost is lower in remote areas due to the lack of access towards the transportation, amenities, and other resources. So when the cost of land increases, the house pricing increases as well. Thank you.
Very good day to you, sir. So based on the issues that have been mentioned earlier by Divya, the government has actually come up with a few solutions. First of all, we'll be looking on the integrated data system established by the Ministry of Housing and Local Government along with the National Property Information Centre and Department of Statistics Malaysia to provide a comprehensive and accurate housing information to ensure balance of supply and demand in the overall housing market. Second of all, it is the responsibility of the government to control and supervise every development takes place in the country. Based on an affordability issue, we have concluded currently there are 6 housing schemes that are available to the public. First of all, the Perumahan Satu Malaysia, followed by the Perumahan Penjawa Awam Malaysia, Skim Rumah Pertamaku, Rumah Wilayah Persekutuan, Skim Perumahan Mampu Milik Swasta, as well as Rumah Selangorku. The objective of implementing housing scheme is actually to ensure that all the people, especially those from the lower and middle income people, as well as government servants, enjoy the privilege of owning or buying an affordable house of their own. Third of all, special scheme has been allocated in the construction sector to provide bridging finance among developers to build houses that are priced 100,000 and below. The government has decided adjustment of loan to value ratio at 70% due to the large number of investment and speculative activities in the housing market. In order to have the housing market stabilized, the approval rate has to be lower, which requires further and more in-depth planning among home buyers before venture into any decisions of a house purchase. Besides that, a rent-to-own scheme allows buyer to own property through rental structure. However, there are terms and conditions applies. For example, it requires a guarantor as well as a combined household income of 5,000 and above to be eligible of rent-to-own scheme. Besides that, based on the Bank Negara Malaysia's latest publish of OPR rate has been reduced to 2.75%, which reduced the financial burden among home buyers. This is because when expenses is reduced, disposable income increase, which improves the individual spending power that leads to the recovery that is a very desirable current economic conditions of Malaysia. Next, the BSN Youth Housing Scheme is a financing for first home ownership aged between 21 to 45 years old that provides monthly incentive of 200 ringgit for up to 2 years. Besides the flexibility in terms of locations wise provided among home buyers. Moreover, the agency credit dan pengurusan credit is a compulsory program established by the Bank Negara Malaysia to ensure all the individuals in search of a approval mortgage loan to obtain financial management education. This is to ensure the capabilities of the people to fulfill their financial obligations in the future. Last but not least, the stamp duty exemption is introduced through home ownership campaign to reduce the burden of additional costs implied on the house purchase. Next, Pareto principle is established by Wilfredo. In another way, it's an 80-20 rules or the wider field, the trivial many. It means 80% of the consequences was caused by 20% of the uncommon. In another way, it is the inequality between outputs and inputs where nothing is equal because minority will always prevail over majority of the populations. For example, in Italy, 80% of the federal land was owned by the 30% of the population, which leads to economic issues such as monopoly element and rich and poor gap. On the other hand, in Malaysia's housing market, the government initiatives may not be able to satisfy all wants. For example, the reduced mortgage loan may only help the populations of T20, but not B40 because the issues of oversupply, overprice, and unaffordability issues remain a few concerns in the housing market. As a solution, the government has to conduct narrow focusing in order to ensure every group of the populations has obtained their assistance from the government to ensure a more balanced income distribution. As a conclusion, policies and regulations involved in monitoring the issues happening in the housing market, including first of all the monetary policy established by the Bank Negara Malaysia under Section 22 of Bank Malaysia Act 2009 to regulate money supply by way of influencing the interest rate. Secondly, the national housing policy was introduced by the Prime Minister under the 10 Malaysia plan to provide adequate and sustainable housings, as well as the Town and Country Planning Act 1976 to control and monitor the development order in the country. I would like to pass the following presentations to Vicky. Thank you.
Sir, my name is Vicky. So I will talk about the urban structure. So there are three types of urban structure. The first one is the concentric zone theory. This theory was introduced by Ernest Burgess in 1923 to explain how social groups are divided into the urban areas. So he also divided them into five areas. The first one is the central business district, which was actually the central focus of non-residential activities. The second part is the mix of residential and commercial users, which include lesser quality industrial and residential areas, whereby immigrants, communities, or individuals, they initially will stay in the tiny residential neighborhood, which generally built by subdividing the large houses into apartments. So the third area is the low-class residential houses, or also identified as the inner city. So this is the zone of the working class residences, which contain the moderate older buildings that occupied by sustainable and working class families. The fourth one is the middle class home. This is a better residences zone where it contains the newer and more spacious houses for middle class families. And the last one is the communal zone across the continuous built up area of the city. Individuals who work in the city, they will still choose to stay in small villages that have become housing areas for commuters. So this model actually was developed solely in Chicago. So the sloping line across the center shows the coast of Lake Michigan. To the left of this section, it just describes the nature of Chicago with the name and styles of the place. To the right section, he defined the terms he assigns to each region. The model is useful because it shows a somewhat simplified version of reality that could be generalized to many cities. Undoubtedly, it doesn't explain why these areas are in those places, but it's the foundation for theories that make the one the main one, which is big rent. So there are a few limitations of this model. So this model actually was developed for the American cities, and it also had limited application to other cities or countries. So even in the United States, the towns are actually no longer organized into single region. So other than that, the land also can restrict the growth of certain industries such as like mountains and water features, which may cause some areas particularly inappropriate for residential purpose. So of course, the advantage of this model tends to be that the CBD is actually at the center point of the economy, which all zones are linked to the CBD. So the next one is the sector theory, which actually established by Homohol in 1933, which he stated that various income groups or classes in the city likely to stay in the district areas that can be described in terms of the circle around the city center. As referred to this figure, the waterline here is a major transit path where the business embracing this waterway. So the lower classes, they on the other side, they embrace the manufacturing belt, where they would consider a means of employment. So the middle and upper classes extend to the open, but still they have reasonable connection to the CBD. So the limitations of this model is there are just river lines that are listed for this, but does not provide the provision of private paths. It is also a monocentric portrayal of the cities, where this concept does not include multiple business centers. The third one is the physical features might very well prevent or guide the growth along particular wedges. There's no reference on the development outside the town as well. And the advantages of this model is it examines the impact of the transport and communication connection. This model seems to have been adopted by several towns when rotated 90 degrees anti-clockwise. It actually appears to fit the town of Newcastle to time with reasonable accuracy. So the past form of wedges created substituted for the disadvantage of the ring model. So although it's not perfect, but it does take into consideration of the lines of the development. So the third one, the third model is multiple nuclear theory, which developed in 1943. So it stated that separate structures of activity, they will expand in lines with the particular requirement of those operations. So the different rent paying capacities and the tendency of those forms of economic operation to cluster together. So which means that the major cities, they were actually creating broad suburban areas, and some neighborhoods, they are having reached considerable size where operating as smaller districts. Such smaller business districts, they serve as the satellite nodes or the nucleus of operation around which trends of the land use were created. So the core of their model is the CBD, with the light manufacturing and the full service equipment located along the transport route. So the heavy industry was supposed to be concentrated near the outer edge of the city, so maybe surrounded in the low-income households and suburbs with workers and smaller services service centers will dominate the metropolitan outskirts. For example, the fast-growing, the younger or the more industrialized cities, such as the large cities such as like Houston and LA. So according to a research done by Moshin and Anwar in year 2015, they suggested that the multiple nuclear theory can actually apply to the city of Mahawapo was to use to identify the possible land uses to enable the municipality to illustrate the infrastructure shortage areas of the city. So the application of the model shows the significance in similarities in urban land use with different development directions and land usage. The possible land uses listed included the CBD, the high, medium, and low classes residential and suburban areas, residential and industrial suburban. So the business centers may have primarily been located along the roadside. The limitation of this model is the height of buildings are being ignored. The second one is the division between the zones do not exceed. The third one is every region, they have a large level of internal heterogeneity and not homogeneity. There is no concern of the influence of the fiscal relief and government policy. The concept may not be applicable to Asian cities with the diverse culture, economic, and political context. The advantages of this model is There are many sources indicate that slight variation on the concept shown in the illustration. So as the model is rather robust and adapts to the local situation, although the exact location of the nuclei are not significant, but only the basic trend, so that it can be adjusted to suit the region under consideration. So that's all for our presentation today. Thank you.